So I've been doing this podcast for the last couple of years, which blows me away. It almost seems like yesterday that I brought the business case to our CEO and said, I've got this crazy idea. And, you know, it has always been my dream to interview people who embody what it means to be resilient. And for the most part, we interview business executives, leaders, all who have lived through our tagline, crisis, risk, and disruption, and they're typically in the business environment. However, I have always believed, and we've had some incredible interviews of people who bring to life their personal stories, not their business stories, but their personal stories, and stories that have literally changed the trajectory and the purpose of that individual's life. And, you know, well-being seems to be one of these kind of overused terms that everybody's talking about in business today. But I think there's really a good reason for that. And if there was ever a time for well-being, I would argue it's today. Here's a few fun facts from our friends at Gallup. 8 in 10 people experience stress every day. Now, I am a CPA, so I could say that's 80% of people. That is mind-boggling that every day most people have some stress in their lives. Americans, and I don't think this is going to surprise anybody, but our weight is going up every single year. We all know the obesity rate's going up. And this is the one that I find most striking, is that only 4 in 10 Americans have had the opportunity to do what they do best in the last year. Think about that. 6 out of 10 of us are doing things that are not aligned with the things that we care about, the things that we like to do, the things that we're actually good at. And I love this one too, from the International Labor Organizations. Americans work 137 more hours per year than Japanese workers. That blew me away. I don't think many of us would have expected that. 260 more hours than British workers and 499 more hours than French workers. But what does this mean, and what does it actually mean for one to become more resilient? Today, we've got Jen Fisher on a Resilient podcast. She is Deloitte's well-being leader. More importantly, she's been a really good friend of mine over the last few years. And while she has this really cool, fancy title, she is a shining example of what it is to be resilient. And at Deloitte, Jen has inspired us through her stories, what makes what she preaches about well-being that much more authentic.
It's not selfish to put yourself first. It's so easy to kind of put ourselves last, right? Or to tell ourselves that taking this time for myself to do what I need to is being selfish. And it's not. As a matter of fact, the people that you care about need you to take care of yourself.
Welcome to the Resilient Podcast, where we hear stories from leaders on crisis, risk, and disruption. And we get those stories by jumping on a plane and meeting our guests on their home turf. And you know what? I've been reflecting on this conversation quite a bit lately. And I think this is going to be even a more important and personal conversation for me because, you know, over the holidays, specifically on Christmas Eve morning, I was in Costa Rica and my son and I almost drowned, which is crazy. I still can't get over that this actually happened. I'm not going to go into all the details, but it really made me think about my purpose. It also, and this is one of the things that I'm working through right now, it made me think quite a bit about all of the weight that we have on us on a daily basis that we filter all of our decisions through. And what I would say is in the immediate aftermath of that experience, I've never had so much clarity. I've never been so aligned with what my purpose is. And the thing that I'm working through is all that weight is beginning to come back. And I don't want it to come back. Because I actually feel if I have that clarity, I'm gonna live a much better life. And that's why I'm excited to talk with Jen Fisher. She really embodies what it is to be resilient, burnout and stress. I'm gonna press her on that one. Being diagnosed and overcoming breast cancer, tactics to be a more resilient leader, and leading well-being at Deloitte. She is doing some incredible things. So let's get to it. My conversation with Jen Fisher, Deloitte's well-being leader. Sitting here in beautiful Manhattan with my good friend Jen Fisher. Jen, welcome to the Little Resilient Podcast.
Thanks, Mike. It's great to be here. Finally, we've been talking about it for a while.
So, Jen, I've known you for the last, probably 3 or 4 years, maybe 5. I don't even know at this
longer
point in time.
Yeah.
And when I think of you and the whole notion of resilience, you are one of the first people that come to my mind. You've been knocked on your butt a couple times. And I want to explore some of those topics, and then I'm going to try to tease out
some of the tactics that you have employed to be more resilient in your life. And then we're going to get into your cool job and how you got that and all that fun stuff. But what I want to do is I want to start with a quote. And we're going to start with your burnout moment. And this is a quote from you. And that quote is, "I was passionate about the work that I was doing, but I burned out. It snuck up on me. I didn't see it, but those close to me did. I needed physical and mental recovery." So I know at Deloitte, I mean, there's a lot of folks within the business world in Deloitte that endure a lot of stress, that do burn out. I want to hear your story.
Okay. So that quote, I think, sums a lot of it up. I always have been very passionate about the work that I do, and I've had multiple roles. And I've always really enjoyed them. And, you know, I dive in, I'm all in. I'm all in. That's, you know, when I decide to do something, I go all in or I don't do it at all. And, you know, so starting out my career, that, you know, I took on a role and I did really well and I got the next role and I did, you know, so kind of my reputation and my work spoke for itself and got me to each next role that I had, but I was all in. And so I loved what I was doing, but I was doing too much of it. My day would be, you know, I would, you know, work for 22 hours. I would go to the gym for an hour and I would get an hour of sleep. And in my mind, that was balanced.
Hopefully you're embellishing just a bit, right?
I am. Absolutely. But the point is to me, that was balanced, right? Because I loved what I was doing. I got my hour of, you know, of time in the gym and I got a little bit of sleep. And so what else did I need in my life, right? And so after I did burn out and I really had to step back and say, wow, like I'm actually defining this whole notion of well-being wrong. Because for me, well-being was that hour of time in the gym. Like that's what was important to me. That was my me time. That was all I believed I needed. And I could just continue to go on.
But did you see any of this? Like, were there any signs where you're like, something's just off? This isn't working for me before, I guess, you came to that moment of reckoning?
Honestly, like, I think while I was going through it, you know, you just power through. Like, you kind of tell yourself, I got this, I can power through. And you take it in small chunks, right? And so it was either by project or event or something, you know, whatever the next big deadline was, you kind of play games in your mind and say, okay, well, I can get to, you know, September 9th and then I'm going to take a vacation or then I'm going to relax or then I'm going to get good sleep. But, you know, what was happening was, you know, in my work life, I wasn't fun to work with. You know, the people that work, I mean, I wasn't.
Do you think that impacted people wanting to work with you?
Absolutely. Yeah. I have a dear friend of mine, and you know, we're good friends because she had the courage to. She left my team, and she had the courage to sit down with me and say, "I love you dearly, and you're a great friend, and I want you in my life, but I can't work for you."
And this was before the burnout moment, though, right?
But I think it was during. I think it was during burnout. Okay. I think it. Yes, but not until after the fact, right? Like I think it made me. At first I was defensive, you know, and I think that's kind of probably a natural reaction, right? And then you kind of rationalize all of these things in your head about, okay, well, I get it. You know, this is what her career goals are. She has a family, you know, all of these things about why this role wasn't good for her. And I was okay with that. Like it wasn't a judgment, but I kind of rationalized that it wasn't about me.
Right. This is why I was so excited about this, because there's almost early signs of kind of why you needed to go through your own personal well-being moment. Yeah. And now you're our leader, which we will talk about later. Yeah. But it's awesome because it shows that you can change.
Well, and that's the thing. Like I tell people all the time, and I know we're going to talk about the role that I'm in and kind of that journey, but I wouldn't be where I am today or doing what I'm doing today or the person that I am today if I hadn't gone through those things. And so, I mean, you started out by saying I've gotten knocked on my butt a couple of times. Yeah, but that's made me who I am. And so do I resent or regret any of it? No, because I've turned it into, and this is going to sound really cliche, but I've turned it into an opportunity. Like I have spent the time to reflect on it and grow from it. And it could be very easy for me to kind of go back to that person, right? And so there's triggers or there's things in place now where I'm like, okay, wait, no, we're not going back.
So how do you manage that? Because one of the things, so I'm, I think, wired a lot like you. And there are times, you know, I'm very calm, I meditate all the time, but then something happens and it makes me revert back to like this person I don't want to be.
Yeah.
And it's hard to snap back into that person I want to be. Do you have any kind of hacks to kind of recognize it at that point in time?
Yeah, and I think it depends on the situation and when it happens. And so, you know, I think email is a big trigger for me. Mm. So I get an email and I read it, and depending on where I am and what's going on in my day and my life and my world and my head, my perception of what you're asking of me is totally different than what your intention was sending the email. And so I have a tendency to be very reactive and reactive in that I want to respond right away so you feel like I'm being responsive to you, right? But that also can come off as me being very insensitive or direct, because I'll just, like, I won't even say, like, hey, Mike, thanks for the email, blah, 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 like, whatever. No niceties. I'll just be like, blah, 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 here's your answer, you know? And then that kind of hits you back where you are, right? And so I think the thing that we have to think about when we're sending emails is, okay, you know, I have this intention, but I don't know where Mike is or what Mike is doing. And so for me, it's, you know, if there's an email that like triggers me or like gets me like, oh my God, I got to respond to this right now, I will actually say, you know what? No, pause.
Walk away,
you know, or if it does get me emotionally worked up because it's something that I'm passionate about or I don't agree with or I have a different point of view on, yeah, walk away. And that's really hard. But there's other things, like if you're in a live meeting and you get triggered by something, look, I always have water around me. And somebody, I don't even know who told me this, but they told me, always have a water bottle with you, because if you drink water throughout the day, I mean, drinking water throughout the day is healthy for you. But if you have water with you in meetings and you get triggered emotionally or something upsets you, you can just excuse yourself and go to the bathroom and everybody will be like, oh, she just gotta go to the bathroom.
Exactly. She's been drinking water all day.
Exactly. So I'll get up and I'll be like, excuse me, I need to go to the restroom. Perfectly normal, natural. And I will go into the restroom and, you know, just kind of take a few deep breaths and reset myself.
I think that's so, I mean, you actually, I know we were talking about email, which quite frankly, I think we could do a whole nother podcast on this because it's actually my big bugaboo. We were even talking earlier, I'd read a statistic or heard it on another podcast that for every email you send, you get 1.74 back, which that just makes me kind of stop because I hate email. One of the things I do is I have a list as a tactic or an activity every single day to call people.
Yeah.
So I try to just move away from email and actually have real conversations because then you can share what your intent is much better
you know,
verbally. But what you're starting to get into is oftentimes we are triggered many, many times. I mean, you're making it sound like, oh, I just get one email or I'm in a meeting. It like happens probably 20 times a day.
Right.
And I think you've already shared a couple good strategies of when that happens, and I don't care how mellow you are or how with it, you still need to have tactics to respond when something kind of gets you.
And I think you need to be aware too of what are the physical symptoms, or like you need to know when you're triggered.
Right.
I actually think that, you know, some people don't.
Yep.
And I would say that I probably didn't, you know.
So let's go back to the whole burnout. We're going to get off of this soon, don't worry, because you're like, let's not talk about this anymore. But I want to know, why do you think you didn't recognize it? Because the signs were there, right?
The signs were there because I perceived it as a weakness, you know, as not being good enough or being able to hold my own and, you know, do the job that I wanted to do, be the wife that I wanted to be the daughter, sister, friend that I wanted to be. And so, you know, I just kept kind of, I think, chipping away at that, right? And so for me to come to terms with it and to admit it to myself and others, that was very vulnerable. And it was admitting, I mean, even though I look back on it now and I don't believe that it was failure, I think it was actually a springboard to so much better that was to come for me. But at the time, you feel like it's failure.
Here's a weakness that I've got. Yeah. Like, I should be able to be the perfect wife. I should be able to be the perfect employee.
And why can't I? And you know, what's wrong with me?
Why can't I have it all?
Yeah. Yeah. Without realizing all of the things that I was doing, like, you know, not taking breaks and not doing, you know, not spending time with people that, you know, that I cared about, or when I did spend time with the people that I cared about, not actually being fully present and engaging with them. And I mean, those are all recovery strategies. Those are the things that make you resilient, right? Like if you're just constantly grinding away,
right?
When are you actually building that resilience muscle? Because grinding, you know, being in the gym, lifting the weight isn't what grows the muscle. It's
the recovery.
Yeah, yep. It's the recovery, right? And so I wasn't recovering.
So somebody out there, I guarantee, is listening and they're in the exact position. What advice would you give to them if maybe all the signs are there or maybe they even recognize it? What would you tell them to do if they're in your situation several years ago?
I kind of like want to go back a little bit. So I do think that I recognized it. I think I didn't want to admit it. And I certainly had people that along the way pointed it out in the most possible way. And I actually needed someone to almost punch me in the face, right? And like force.
So like people were saying, hey, Jen, you may be working a little too much or pushing yourself too hard.
Yeah, or taking things too hard. I mean, my husband all the time would be like, this isn't life or death. Don't take these things so hard. I mean, so he would try to gently nudge me to kind of get me to reframe or to see things differently or to do things differently. And you're closed off, right? Because you're in survival mode.
You don't get this world I'm living in, honey. This is the way it is.
Yeah.
I mean, I've said that to my wife.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, like you don't get it. It's so important. And I mean, and all of that is true, mm-hmm. right? But to what end? Is it important enough to sacrifice your health and your happiness? Or is there a better way, right? It is important, absolutely. But can you know, there's room to do the things that are really important, do a kick-ass job at your job, be a kick-ass wife, friend, daughter. I mean, there's room in life to do that. And you should be able to do that because that's what makes you a whole person, right? But I was missing that.
So I'm going to come back because you just said something that's going to be a nice pivot to the next question. But I want you to answer the question, which is, what would you tell that person? Like, I am going through hell right now, and this feels like my life, and especially somebody younger in their career. If I don't do this well, it is going to have a major impact on my life for years to come. What would you tell them? Like, what could they or should they do?
Well, I would say, first of all, is it really going to have a major impact on your life for years to come? Or is that emotions that you're feeling that are potentially driven by the fact that you're kind of stuck in this stressed out state
right.
and you can't see the bigger picture? Here's the thing. If you don't talk about it, if you don't get real, number one, with yourself and with others and share what you're struggling with, then nobody's going to know and no one's going to be able to help you.
Right.
And so for me, it was people saw it and they tried to tell me, but I didn't want to listen. So there was only so much they could do.
Right.
Until I was ready to actually acknowledge it myself. Right. And so I think you have to acknowledge it and it's not a weakness
right.
and it's not, and it's okay to be vulnerable and it's okay to say, hey, look, what I'm doing is so important to me. But right now, this is what I need, or I need some help, or I need some recovery, or I need some time off, or I need whatever it is that you think that you need so that I can come back stronger, because this is so important. Because if you keep going, you're going to crash and burn, and that's
right.
not good for you, and that's not good
for
anyone else. And so I think especially in the business world, sometimes you say yes too much because you're passionate
right.
about it, right? And so I think passion could actually lead to burnout, right? Because you're so passionate about it that your filter of like what I should be saying yes and no to is a little bit off, right?
I also think that to a certain degree, especially when you start out, there are certain expectations
yeah.
and you're always trying to kind of beat them. What has probably helped me the most, because I've been in your situation, maybe not to the extreme, but is when I got clear on my purpose.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
it's not just to make the most money or to have the best role. there's a there's multiple parts to kind of who I am. And when I got clear on that, it allowed me to make the other decisions, including where I was spending my time, much better.
Yeah, it's incredibly important to understand what your purpose is. Why do you do what you do? You know, and what's going to sustain you for the long term? You know, right. And what, you know, what's your North Star? And if your North Star changes, that's fine. But just know what your North, like, what is your driving force? Why do you get out of bed in the morning? Why do you do what you do? What's most important to you? And are the decisions that you're making taking you closer to that or taking you farther away from that? You know, that's a great barometer, right? Kind of run it through that filter. But I think in the business world, we need to be a lot more open and authentic about what we need and not view it as a weakness, because I think it's actually a strength.
So one of the things that you said is that when you're working so hard and you have a high degree of stress, it could impact your health. So let's pivot to 2016, which it's like the perfect segue because you got sick.
Yeah.
You had breast cancer.
Yep. So in May of 2016, I found a small lump on my breast. I found it myself. And, you know, that kind of, I don't know if inspired is the right word, but prompted me to say, oh, wait, it's, you know, it's time for, I didn't really.
So you didn't think it was a big deal. It's like, oh, whatever, I'll go to the doctor.
I didn't think much of it. I had just turned 40.
Yeah.
You know, no history of breast cancer in my family. For the most part, I do all of the things that they tell you to do, which I continue to believe are incredibly important. And also, I believe that the lifestyle that I lead maybe didn't prevent me from getting cancer, but it helped me go through my treatment.
Right.
But I went to the doctor, and even, you know, initially my doctor was like, yeah, you know, I don't really think it's anything, but, you know, you just turned 40. It's time for your, you know, for your mammogram.
Right.
So I went, and, you know, I think I did that 2 days later. And then 2 days after that, they called me and told me that I had breast cancer. And, you know, I think at the time, it's still actually a little fuzzy to me.
Where were you when you got that call?
At home.
And so you're like chilling at home.
I was working.
Oh, you were working.
It was working.
Yeah, I was working.
But you know,
hopefully not 22 hours a day at this point.
No, but you're anticipating the phone call, right? You know, so like the second the phone rings and we all have caller ID, so I knew exactly who it was.
Right.
You know, so I picked up the phone and.
What did you think when you picked up? Were you like, oh, it's probably going to be good news, or did you have a gut instinct?
So I mean, here's the thing: when I got my mammogram at the women's center that I went to. The radiologist told me, look, this, I've been doing this for a long time. It doesn't look good, but we don't have, you know,
okay.
Like, you know, they need to do biopsy and all that kind of stuff. And so I think my husband was in a lot more denial than I was. Like, I kind of had said, I'm going to ramp myself up for like the bad news. And that way, if it's good news, I'll just breathe a sigh of relief. If it's bad news, then like I've kind of already gotten myself there. At least that's what I told myself
mentally.
In my head.
Right.
Right. But when you actually hear the words like you have breast cancer or any kind of cancer or any kind of disease, you're never prepared for
right.
it.
Right. So so you get that message. What went through your mind in that instant?
I think at first I think the first thing was I'm gonna die.
Yeah.
You know, because I think when you hear the word cancer, like,
right.
You know, like you think you're going to die. Right?
Yeah.
And then I think I started to kind of think about my life and my job and what did that mean and what was the next, you know, however many years of my life going to look like. And then interestingly, I mean, I don't want to say I actually perceived it, you know, kind of going back to our prior conversation. I don't know that I perceived it as a weakness per se, but it took me a little while to be okay with telling other people about it.
Why do you think that is? Meaning like like it was hard for you to say, hey, I've been diagnosed with cancer?
Yeah, because I unfairly probably judged other people and said if I tell them they're gonna be like I didn't want people to treat me differently. Like I didn't want people to be like, oh my god, you know, let's kind of take it easy on Jen, or let's not invite her to this call, or let's not, you know, because I think that's people's natural tendency is to, especially when you're diagnosed with a disease, they view it as helping you, right? And the right thing to do, and it absolutely is, but I viewed it as like I don't want my life to change because of this, right? Like I don't want to be defined by this, or I don't want to say people to say, don't bother Jen because she's going through cancer right now, right? Like I still wanted to be the Jen that everybody knew. And I was afraid that if I told them, or when I told them, it was going to change their view of
they were going to treat you differently.
Yeah. And I didn't want to.
You hear that all that, like, yeah, that Sheryl Sandberg always talks about how when her husband died, how everybody treated her so differently, and it totally changed her perspective on how to treat people that are in crisis. So let's I'm curious, what would you want now after going through this? If people know somebody that's sick or they're going through a crisis, what is the best way to treat somebody in that circumstance?
Ask them.
Yeah.
Ask them what they need. The thing is everybody deals with it differently.
Right.
You know, and I'm a planner, and so for me to feel better was to start getting my plan.
So you put your cancer project plan together?
I did, and it's the most important project of my entire life.
Right.
You know, but I did. It didn't always go exactly as I had planned, but I had a plan.
I always think that everybody that I've interviewed and any personal challenges I've had in my life, when I look back, even at the time where you're like, God, why is this happening to me? You ultimately look back and say, that was probably the best thing ever to happen to me. Is there anything you've taken away that's changed you, I don't know, to the core of who you are? Anything when you reflect back on it?
Yeah. I mean, gosh, there's a lot. I'm not sure that I would say cancer is the best thing that ever happened to me. I will say that I'm grateful for the experience and what I learned about myself and others too. I think number one, again, cliche, you're stronger than you think you are. I mean,
you have to be in certain respects, right?
Have to be, right? And so I think that's the other kind of mindset shift. You know, I went from I'm going to die, which is a victim, to I've got this.
I'm going to live, right?
Yeah. You know, and that's how I woke up every day, with the intention of I got this, I'm going to live. There was a lot of political, it was during the time of the presidential election.
Yep.
And this is not about political views at all, but we all know what it's like when, I mean, like every ad on television is.
Especially in Florida where you live.
Exactly. So we're a swing state, right? And so every ad on television was a political ad.
Right.
It just felt very negative. Polarizing and negative. And actually what happened was I started watching, I think, Home and Garden television, right? Because it was one of the only channels that I could find. I spent a lot of time in bed. and it was one of the only channels that I could find that didn't have political ads. And at the end of the show, everybody's happy. You know, like the house looks amazing and everybody's happy and the family is there. And, you know, and so I was kind of like, this is good. This is, you know, like, but one of the things I think I learned about myself, which probably a lot of people already knew, but was the power of the mind. You know, not being, you know, this like chipper, super over positive, always happy person, but really, truly, like the power of gratitude and the way that I see things, the way that I would experience things. Like I would go into chemo treatment and I would walk in and have my headphones on and kind of world out with like music that pumped me up. And I would walk in and I'd be like, all right, fight mode on. I got this.
Yeah.
You know, and I would just go in.
Did you have a go-to song that was like, this is what's going to get me through it?
So I did. I think each time walking into treatment, I would listen to Fight Song. You know, a little cliche,
right?
Do you
want to sing it for us?
No. Okay. And you don't want me to sing it. Fight Song by Rachel Platten. This is my fight song. Take back my life. It was not Jen is going in as a cancer patient. It was, this is just something I have to do, and then I'm going back to my life. People were constantly reaching. I mean, I saw the true compassion of humanity. So it was kind of like the yin and the yang, right? I've still got
a lot of fight left in me. So here's a question that you had in your blog, which I find fascinating. And I don't even know if you really have answered it yet or if there is an answer. But it's, why do I feel it's okay to take care of myself when I'm sick but not when I'm healthy? So obviously you're healthy now.
Yeah.
But can you maybe just kind of drill down on that question and kind of what was behind that and whether or not you've come to terms with that question or figured it out?
Yeah, so absolutely. So what was behind that was, you know, when I was going through my cancer treatment, I was relentless in terms of how I managed my day and how I managed my calendar. And so stepping back, I chose to continue working during my cancer treatment. That was my choice.
Right.
I had all kinds of opportunities available to me to do it differently, but I worked with my leadership and I chose to continue working. I chose to continue working because it helped me feel normal.
Right.
I longed for normalcy. But during my cancer treatment, I was relentless about how I managed my calendar. Mm. And so the exhaustion during chemotherapy is something that is very real. And I don't think you can describe it to anyone if they haven't been through it. But the best way I can describe it is you could sleep for hours and wake up and still feel exhausted. And you just can't get rid of that, right? And so I booked nap time in my calendar every single afternoon. And it said nap time in my calendar or me time or, and I communicated it to people. My whole team knew that, from, 3 to whatever, 1 to 3 in the afternoon, right. that was nap time. That was Jen's me time. And I protect, it honestly didn't matter who asked me for a call or if I had time. The answer was no. Because that was my nap
time. And so have you had a challenge of kind of continuing that app? Now that you're well, yeah. Have you had a challenge?
Yeah. And so once I got through treatment, I was like, you know what? I kind of would start rationalizing in my head. Like, yeah, I know it's blocked as my me time. But, and it'd start giving that up little by little. And I would see that eroding. And in my mind, I would be like, okay, well, I had an excuse
right.
when I was sick, right? Because I really, truly needed
it. You had to have it.
Right.
Now it's like, well, now it's a nice thing
right.
to have.
Right, I had to have right? it to get through my day. But now do I really have to have it to get through my day? Or am I just being selfish?
Right.
And that's what goes on in my mind.
So, but you've gotten to the point now where you've gotten back to that consistency, right? For the most part.
When I got out of treatment, too, it was freedom.
Right.
So people would ask me to do something. I'd be like, yeah, I'm all in. I'm all in.
I'm back.
Back. And then I kind of realized, wait, like traveling a lot, I'm tired. I was starting to kind of go down the path of saying yes too much because I'd been forced to kind of stay grounded and say no for a long time. That like when I didn't have to say no, I kept saying yes and yes and yes and yes because all of them were good opportunities. But again, that goes back to they're great opportunities. You're passionate about it. You enjoy it. You thrive on it. But it can still wear you down if you're not careful.
So, Jen, one of the things that I've gotten really interested in lately is when something like cancer hits you. My hypothesis, because I have a story of my own, but my hypothesis is that for once in your life, you look at everything very clearly. Like all that weight that we use to filter decisions is gone. Like, societal expectations, personal expectations, you could go down
the
list.
Because it becomes about survival.
Right, yeah. Right. So the thing that I find fascinating, though, is now you're well and all that crap just gets loaded back up. And I'd love for you just to kind of reflect on that vis-a-vis your personal story and what all that means.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a really, really important question. And there's so much truth to it because I will tell you, the moment you get diagnosed with cancer, you have that moment of clarity of,
right.
what really matters in life. And it
you go working 22 hours a day probably is not the most important thing, right?
Or working at all.
Or working at all, right.
It becomes about surviving,
right.
Like what are the things I need to do to survive, to get
right.
to get through this? I think you also wake up every day with clarity in terms of what really matters, because you wake up with a sense of like, I first of all, I don't really have control of what's going on. So you realize that as much as you think you might have control, you have no control.
Right.
And so every day is a gift, right? You wait, because you're suddenly faced with, especially for me, because I was diagnosed at a young age, right? And so this whole notion of death or dying or, any of that kind of stuff, like it was so far, like it's so far off. Like you don't think about it every day. Like it's going to happen. Yeah, it's going to happen to all of us. But for me, it was like, it's many, many, many years down the road. And then you get told you have cancer and you're like, wait, maybe death isn't so far down the road. And so every day becomes, okay, I'm going to like live this day to the fullest of whatever that day is. I mean, some days that's sitting on the couch and doing nothing, right? But there is a sense of clarity. But I would say the one thing is, and I'm really, really aware of it, and it's really important to me, the further I get away from treatment and the more life goes back to normal or whatever the new normal is, you know, and the less I think about cancer and more about kind of life, which is a really positive thing, it's hard, you know. I mean, like, you kind of go back into like
the not the rut, but the way you lived your life,
right?
Before.
So some of that clarity, some of that crystal, like that clearness that you had every day when you woke up and going through treatment, you know, that dissipates because you're further and further and further away from it. And so there are things that I try to do every single day. So, I mean, there are constant reminders in my life.
Right.
I have to take medication.
Right.
So and there are side effects to the medication that I take. And they're not great, but they're not terrible either. But I kind of had an aha moment one day when I was having a conversation with someone. But I would wake up in the morning and I would take, you know, pick up the medication. And I'm not somebody who's ever had to take medication, so this is really hard for me. But I would take the bottle of medicine and I would be really negative. I'd be like, oh, I have to take this medicine. I hate it. It makes my joints hurt. This, you know, like, and I would go through all the things that I didn't like about it. And then I kind of realized, you know what? Like, you can agree or disagree on kind of, you know, like modern medicine and whether or not you think that, you know, it's helping or not. But the truth is this is the best we have right now. And it's what my doctors believe I need to do to live a long and thriving life. And so I started to change my intention around that medication. And instead of being negative about it, every morning when I take that pill, I'm like, this pill is like saving my life. I get to go get up and go to work and go to the gym and have dinner with my family and meet with my friends and do. And this pill is what's allowing me to do.
You're showing
that.
Gratitude for the pill.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know,
no,
so
in all sincerity, but that is what is allowing you to thrive.
But it's also that reminder every day of the clarity that I had going through treatment. And so I'm able to kind of sustain that and bring that to my everyday.
Yeah, this is something that I'm personally giving a lot of thought to, is how do you not lose that moment?
It's really easy to lose. Really easy.
Yep. Yeah. I want to go back. One of the things that I've observed is oftentimes there are signals, and it gets back to that rock bottom moment. There are signals. And what I've begun to figure out is kind of paying attention to those signals, and then not just knowing that they're there, but actually stepping back and really reflecting on, what does this mean for me? And then what should I change in my life? Because if I don't change something, it's going to become a bigger issue down the road. But everybody knows what those signals are. Pay attention to them is what I found.
Yeah. I mean, I think everyone knows what those signals are, but it's also, it's easy to ignore them. Because change is hard.
Change is hard.
You know, and so it's easier to kind of keep doing what I'm doing because I know that. And that's familiar
to me. It's hardwired.
Yeah, and self-awareness is hard too, right? Because you kind of have to admit some things to yourself that, you know, maybe you don't want to admit. You know, like, I'm not capable of being superwoman and being everything to everyone all the time.
Right.
That sucks, but it's the truth.
It's liberating when you figure that out, though.
Yeah.
You talked about your evening routine.
Yeah, so I don't think there's anyone around that kind of hasn't heard the impact of electronic devices and, you know, blue light on our sleep. But also I think that there's an importance of beyond kind of what we know those physical impacts are, you know, the psychological impact of truly being able to kind of disconnect from work and the world around you before you go to bed. Because I often hear from people like, I don't sleep well because I can't shut my mind off, you know? And I'm like, okay, well, are you like going directly from like watching the news to bed, so you have all that stuff swirling around in your head? Or are you going directly from like answering emails to bed? And that was me.
Do you sleep with your computer?
I used to.
I'm not asking you, I'm saying like the proverbial you, but yes.
You know, I mean, somebody at some time told me, like, if you were a life coach, like, would you ever tell the person you were coaching to like roll over in the morning and check their email? Like before you even sit up in bed. But like, how many of us do that? Because we sleep with our phone, you know, and then people are like, oh, but my phone's my alarm. I'm like, okay, but put it on the dresser. You know, like it's, you're still going to hear it. You just don't need to, you know, now there's research coming out about the impact to like truly to our brain and brain tumors and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So that's another reason like not to have it right next to your head all of the time. But my sleep rituals is, you know, electronic devices of any kind, at least go away at least an hour before bed.
Like out of the room.
Out of the room.
Wow.
Yeah. Reading an actual book, like, you know, a physical book. Yeah, they do exist.
Right.
Journaling, you know, kind of taking some time to, even if it's, and it sometimes it's long, sometimes it's short, but I always try to kind of write down the five things that I'm grateful for that happened that day, right? And so I think, and I know gratitude is a big thing for you too, Mike, but the interesting thing about gratitude and kind of keeping a gratitude list is that I try to not repeat in too close of a sequence the things that I'm grateful for. Because it's, I think, you know, when you ask
somebody, like you try not to go to your go-to gratitude.
Yeah, because everybody's going to say, you know, my family. Right. Like, I mean, there's, and of course, absolutely, I'm grateful for those. But, you know, like when you tell yourself, okay, I can't repeat that for 10 days. Like, then you get down to like, I'm really grateful for the fact that I have a pair of running shoes that I can put on in the morning when I want to go work out. Or that like I flip the switch and the electricity comes on. Or, you know, I mean, like things that we take for granted in our life because there's, I mean, we're so fortunate and there's abundance in our world, right? For a lot of people, there's not. And so when you do something where you say, okay, you can't be great, like, okay, you're grateful for the big things. What are the little things? And then you start to really, like, I recognize, like, I see things differently now. Like,
what's
I
like
see,
a funny grateful thing that you've thought about in the last 2 weeks? Like that may not be apparent. Turning on the electricity is actually kind of one that I wouldn't have thought of, but anything.
So recently I had to get glasses for distance.
Right.
And so, you know, because I was having trouble seeing, it was blurry at night when I was driving and, you know, I'm not a great nighttime driver either. So, you know, that just compounds the problem. But so I got glasses and I started wearing the glasses and I was out walking my dog and we live in Miami, beautiful, right on the bay. And I like looked up at the trees and I was like, wow, I can actually like see the detail on that leaf. And so I was very grateful. I mean, it was kind of like an aha. And I was like, I'm really like, that's very cool. I'm grateful. Cause before I could see the tree and I knew it had leaves, but it was kind of almost like a Monet painting, you know,
right.
It was like all blurred together. And so I knew it was a tree and leaves and there wasn't a problem. Like it wasn't like I couldn't see it. But then when I put the glasses on, it was like kind of, now I could see things a lot more clearly. Like I actually see like the lines and the details on a leaf.
I think the reason why this is, I mean, people may be like, this is so cheeky right now, like they were talking about
yeah.
this. But I think the reason why it's so important is if you can actually create a habit of being grateful mm-hmm. for everything, the things, like you said, that we take for granted, like nature,
mm-hmm.
but it then starts to instill a behavior, the way that you live your life, because you look at everything differently. Every interaction.
Well, and tying it to resilience, right? Resilience. I mean, a great tool for resilience is gratitude, right?
Absolutely.
So if you get knocked down or something doesn't go the way that you wanted it to go, or you had a bad meeting with a client or your boss or a fight with your spouse or whatever it is, sitting down and writing the things that you're, that's so easy. Writing the things that you're grateful for. Five things that I'm grateful for right now.
Right.
The chemistry in your body and your brain. And I mean, there's research and data that shows what it does. Right. But what an easy and awesome tool that we all have. It doesn't take anything, you know, a pen and a piece of paper. Or if you don't have a pen and a piece of paper, okay, you do it on your electronic device,
right,
you know.
Right.
but even, or just think about it. Right. I mean, that brings you back to a place of like, okay, wait, it's not as nearly as bad as I think it is. But I travel a lot in my job. And I found that when I was traveling, I was even sleeping worse. And so as I started to kind of read about this whole, you know, setting up rituals and the signals to your brain that it's time to wind down, that it's time to go to sleep, I realized that while I'm not sleeping in my own bed, I can still create the same environment and the same signals to my brain.
Right.
So I liken it to like when you're a child, right? When you're getting ready for bed, you have all of these rituals that you don't know that they're rituals because your parents are like, go brush your teeth, go do this, go do that, then get in bed and I'll read you a story. All of those are sleep rituals. It's just when we get older, we stop doing those things, right? And we crash right into bed from whatever it was that we were doing before without kind of putting those things into place that say, hey, brain, it's time to wind down and go to sleep.
So one of the things that I think you and I have in common, and you wrote something about the importance of meditation. How important do you think that is to resilience and your well-being?
So I will be completely transparent. I'm a huge fan and believer of meditation. I and probably every meditator will say this, my practice is fledgling at best. and I'm completely judgmental of myself and the fact that I'm don't do it right. And, you know, and I can't shut my brain off and I can't stop thinking and I can't, right. All these things. But again, I think meditation is if you don't believe all of us that are out there talking, I mean, there's so much science behind the benefits of meditation. And so you can't deny it. But I think, it's just a way to control those emotional and mental swings throughout the day. Because, again, it's all about simple tools. You know, we talked about gratitude and just writing down or thinking things. Your breath is always with you. And once you learn to use that as a tool to gain control of whatever situation that you're in, that's really powerful. And for me, I think that's what I've learned from it, right? Is, you know, I can, and it's easy. Like, I can take 3 deep breaths sitting in a meeting and no one's going to know that I'm doing it,
absolutely.
Right? But it just centers me, and the biology and the physiological, all the data and the science will tell you what that does for you, right? And so you have to kind of experience it for yourself. But it goes back to being able to be more engaged and present, kind of not have those like really high highs and low lows throughout the day, but really kind of say, okay, I'm walking into this meeting, this is who it's with, this is the object, you know, like, and be there and be present and be engaged. Or if it's with my family, you know, I'm going out to dinner with my husband. Like, I don't want all these other
things.
Yeah.
Well, and it's amazing. I mean, I think there's so many things that are going around in our mind, 99% of which really don't matter, will not happen. And for me, what it's allowed me to do is to clear out a lot of that. Yeah. But then when we were talking earlier about kind of the stimulation and response, it's created that gap between like something happens and I normally would jump on it. Now I kind of I use that little space that it's created. And I, quite frankly, you know, irrespective of the science behind it, doesn't even really matter to me, because I could tell if I don't do it on a given day that it changes the trajectory of the entire day. I didn't yesterday, right. And I had a really bad day, quite frankly. And I was like, well, what changed? Ah, I didn't do that.
Right.
And I think it's not necessarily the bad day because of external stimuli, it's because of how I responded to it.
Right.
So,
well, that's the only thing we can control, right? And so you can't control what the external stimuli is or isn't going to be, but you can control your response to it. And meditation is a way to get there.
In your erratic practice, what do you do? What you say you don't, nobody does it well. So they'll just get that out of the way. So if you were to do it on a given day, what would you, do you use an app? Do you just take some blank space, or
I do sometimes use an app. I do. Okay. I like a guided meditation because, again, for me, sitting in complete silence is hard. And so I like kind of having the guided nature of it. And it's probably because I actually need to do it more to get to a place where sitting in silence isn't so hard for me. Right. I'm fully aware of that. But yeah, so I do use an app. I mean, there'll be times that, you know, one of the things that, and my husband is actually much better about this than I do. So I mentioned before, I mean, we live in Miami, Florida, which is paradise. And we live on the water, and off of our balcony, we see the sunrise over Biscayne Bay.
I think
morning.
We're Facebook friends, and I'm like super jealous because I see the picture he takes every morning.
Yeah. You know, and that's his kind of meditation and gratitude. And sometimes I'll be like, I'm not getting out of bed until the coffee's ready, you know, but he's really good about kind of taking, you know, and it's not a long time. It's not 30 minutes. It's, you know, 5, 10 minutes, 15 minutes where, you know, the weather's beautiful. Go and sit out on the balcony and look at the water and put a pair of headphones on. And, you know, and again, trying to kind of replicate that in hotel rooms. I think we touched on it a little bit before, but, you know, I had kind of said, like, if you were a life coach, you would never tell somebody to like roll over in the morning and check their email. Right. I think it's really important to start your day with intention, right? And whatever that intention is, like some people will talk about, like it's really important for them to make their bed in the morning. So they get up and the first thing they do is make their bed, right? Like to me, that is starting your day with some action or some intention that is setting kind of the tone for the rest of how your day is going to go. You know, rolling out of bed and kind of crashing into work, into email without, you know, then everything that comes your way is, you know, you're going to be like whack-a-mole, right? Yep. Yeah, exactly. You know, so it's, things are going to pop up, you know, and you're going to whack it down. They're going to pop up and whack it down instead of saying, this is, you know, this is kind of my intention for the day. Now, recognizing that a lot of times it won't go the way that you intended it to.
So we got into this conversation really around things that you can do to be more resilient in life. And there's three words that are kind of popping up, I think, over and over. And to a certain degree, you as an individual have to come up with your own secret sauce.
Yeah.
But it's almost clarity on purpose. We keep coming back to that. Rituals. And there's a lot of different rituals. And we could even talk about, you know, exercise and food. And there's a lot of things that you should do there. And then also, I think probably the most important is maybe being intentional about your day. And one of the things that I found is the more that I can actually be very thoughtful about what are the things that I want to get done in a certain day, like what are the top three? I write down every day, I have to get these top three things done and nothing else matters. And I do that the night before. But I think the more you're intentional about your day, the easier it is to be resilient kind of in those times of crisis.
Where it
do you
doesn't
agree with
go
that?
Exactly how you planned. Yeah. And I think the other thing is simplicity.
Ooh.
Don't overcomplicate it. These things don't have to be hard.
I want you to drill down. I was about to move on to my next topic, but maybe can you go a little deeper in that?
Yeah. So, you know, a lot of the kind of tactics that we've already talked about are really simple, you know. Starting your day with five, like writing down what your intention, you know, how long does that take you every night?
Oh, 2 minutes.
Right.
Yeah. If that.
It's easy. I mean, so don't make it some, you know, big thing. So if you overcomplicate it and you make it too big or too difficult, rituals shouldn't be like big and difficult because then you're going to come up with excuses as to why you can't do them, right? Because I don't have enough time or because this got in the way or because, so the more simple that you can make them, but you're more likely to do them, and then they're going to become habits. They're just going to become the way that you live your life or the way that you structure your day. And so, you know, think about it in small bits. Like, what is one small thing that I can start doing differently for the next 3 weeks?
I thought where you're going with that, so this is maybe an and, is not only simplifying kind of the tactics or the things that you do, but also simplifying your life. I think one of the things that I've experienced probably over the last 10 years is that I've overcomplicated my life. And what I mean by that is doing too many things, making too many commitments, having too many things, whatever it may be. And so my wife and I are going through this extreme, almost minimalism simplification. And it's not just about getting rid of crap in my home, which we are doing, but it's also just even simplifying finances, simplifying your calendar, simplifying everything. And almost in some regards, taking choice out, because we're bombarded with so many decisions that we need to make during the course of the day. So if you can take a lot of those decisions out, it then allows you to focus on what matters.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, absolutely. I think as much as I personally, I'm not very good at that, but
we could talk later.
But one of the things that I did decide to do, and this was prompted by my husband, who's really good at kind of making me self-aware when I'm not self-aware, is I like clothes and shoes, and my closet is, there's no room for any more clothes or shoes in my closet. And so over the holidays, I did, you know, do a purging of my closet and gave a whole bunch of stuff to Goodwill. And now I have a new rule. Whenever I get a new item of clothing or a new pair of shoes, I have to give one away.
See, I thought you were going to say, now that I got rid of them all, then I treated myself to the after Christmas sales to
a bunch of new
stuff.
I mean, I might have done some of that too, but, you know, new rule. When something new comes in, something goes out. And so I, you know, and so there's a constant kind of purging because just like, I mean, that's probably a good metaphor for everything else. And I mean, things just pile up, right? And you just continue to collect stuff. I think your mind works the same way. I mean, that's probably another good reason for meditation. It's a cleansing. It's a purging of like all the crap that builds up in your mind over time, right? So, but yeah.
what's your official title? Deloitte's well-being leader, I think I see. But what's like if on your
National
business
National Managing Director of Well-Being.
That's a big title. How the heck did you get that job?
Well, first of all, I truly believe that I have the best job in the firm. And
I think you may. Just for the record.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the great thing about Deloitte is there's a lot of great roles.
Right.
But I'm incredibly grateful for the role that I have, and I'm incredibly proud of our firm for recognizing the need for a role like this and the importance to our business and just, you know, the business world at large, and how important it is to truly care about your people and to support them and promote them and taking care of their well-being. But, you know, I think how it all came about.
I was going to say, I didn't think you were going to answer the question, but now you're going to.
So how it all came about, and this kind of goes back to, you know, my own story of burnout and my personal journey. You know, once I kind of got through burnout and you know, got back on my feet, and, you know, I spent a lot of time with one of my mentors who really pushed me to think about what was important to me. You know, where did I want to go in my life, and what was I passionate about? Because I didn't know. I mean, it kind of goes back to, you know, the importance of personal purpose. I don't know that I didn't have personal purpose, because I think if I dug deep down, I could find it, but I certainly wasn't driven by it. Like, it didn't factor into the way that I was living my life.
Isn't that, but I mean, on some level, I totally get it, because I've been there too, and I think a lot of people out there are, but isn't that bizarre in some weird way that, like, we got one life, and we sometimes are living without really understanding kind of why we're doing what we're doing.
It is, and I mean, I think, you know, like, I could stand there and say, like, look, I've been really successful in my career. I have an amazing family, you know, that's very loving and supportive. I have great friends. You know, I'm financially very sound, but I don't know what, like, I don't know why I'm doing what I'm doing.
Right.
I mean, I could say that, you know, and that's kind of where I was. And so she really pushed me to say, like, Jen, what do you love? Like, what do you love doing? And I've always had a personal passion for well-being. And so, you know, I spent some time, I did some research, I talked to her on multiple occasions, and I said, you know, this is what I'm really passionate about, but I didn't have the vision to actually see how I could make it come to life.
It's not like there was a posting for the National Managing Director of
Well-Being.
It didn't exist.
We've, you know, as an organization, we certainly have, you know, evolved and been on this journey, and we've always had great programs around, you know, workplace flexibility and, you know, formal programs and, you know, kind of the whole notion of work-life balance, which is a bit of a dated concept in my view, just given the ways that we work. And, you know, there's not work and life, there's just life.
Right.
Having a meaningful career part of your life is great if that's what you choose. But, you know, and so it was kind of those things in combination with what I'd learned about my own personal journey and burnout and how important it was to take care of myself and to more broadly define well-being. Because I talked to you earlier about, you know, for me, well-being was that hour of the day where I went to the gym. And that was great for my physical well-being. And yes, certainly there was, you know, some mental well-being in there because that was kind of what I needed. But it was still too narrow, right? Like, there was so much more that I needed because I'm a whole person. And you can't just focus on one aspect of it and expect it to, you know, fix everything else.
I think, tell me if this is what you're getting at. It's almost like you can't just segment a part of your life where you're like, oh, I'm going to be well this 1 hour out of 24 hours. That, I mean, even when you just step back, that just makes absolutely no sense, which gets back to the work-life balance. It's like you're living your life.
Yeah.
Live a good life.
Yeah. And I mean, what I say about work-life balance, and the reason I say that nothing's ever in balance, ever, you know, and so what I tell people is it's a rhythm, right? And sometimes you're going to give more to work. And sometimes, hopefully, you're going to have that dip and you're going to give more to personal life and family or the things that matter to you. As long as there's a, you know, a consistent or some sort of rhythm over time, it's okay to have those peaks, you know, those highs and lows where you're giving more to work. As a matter of fact, I think it's really, really healthy. But it's never in balance, you know, because you're never like we don't live in, you know, in the 70s anymore. It's, you know, you don't shut down at the end of the day and leave the office and go home and not, you know, be connected. We're connected. And that's the world we live in. It's the world we want to live in, but it's more about how, okay, we live in that world. How are we going to manage it? Right. And it's about, and to me, it's about rhythm.
What the heck does well-being even mean to you?
What it means to me is actually, quite frankly, how we also define it at Deloitte. It's whole person. It's body, mind, and purpose. It's, you know, it's what makes up who you are.
Right.
You know, how are you fueling your body? It's not about diet. It's not about, you know, everybody needs to lose weight or be a certain weight or have a certain BMI. I mean, it's not that. It's how are you fueling your body and what's your relationship with food, and how are you using that to actually be your best self?
Yep.
It's about movement throughout the day. So a lot of people say, I don't like exercise. I don't have time to exercise. I'm like, fine. Can you get up and go for a 15-minute walk? Like, let's start there. Can you climb the stairs in between floors in your office? Or, you know, I mean, there's multitude of things you can do. Certainly exercise is important, and we want that. So movement, exercise, rest, recovery, including sleep.
Can we hit on the movement? Because I actually think this may be one of our biggest challenges just in the business world.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, part of what I'm trying to do is how do I actually integrate movement into my day? Yeah. And one of the things I've started to do is when I get on a conference call, I actually will put my headset on and take a walk. And I actually find that I'm more productive because I'm more focused. Like, I'm not getting pinged by IM reason or why email or whatever.
I mean, and there's scientific reasons why. I mean, what happens to your brain when you're moving,
right.
too.
Right. Okay, so we've got the body piece. Yeah. Now move on to, so then...
Mind is, you know, really all aspects of your mental and emotional health, but it includes things like your mental focus. So how long can you stay focused and what is your engagement like with other people? Mental health in our society, in our world, in the business world, it's a real issue. And it's an issue in that I think we all need to recognize that, you know, there's a spectrum of mental wellness and mental illness, and we all fall on that spectrum somewhere. And you don't know what someone's going through in their life or what's going to trigger something for you or for someone else, right? And I think in the business world in particular, I think we need to focus on that a little bit more. And also, you know, there's a stress component to that, you know, and how you're dealing with stress and how you're managing it and what are you doing to recover, you know, because, you know, burnout is on that spectrum for sure. And if you burn out and you don't bounce back, I mean, there's all kinds of things that burnout could lead to, you know, to substance abuse, to depression, to, I mean, right? And so, look, I was there or one step away from it,
right.
quite frankly, right? And so we're all susceptible to it. And it's not, so we really need to remove the stigma around mental health and in society, but in particular in the workplace, and support one another and kind of have an understanding of what that is and how we can help each other. And it's not about diagnosing each other. It's just about supporting each other.
What's interesting, going back to the mental focus, which I find all the time, and I think this will resonate with everybody that's listening, is oftentimes when you're like heads down and then you just step away for a half an hour, you come back and you solve it like immediately.
That's what you get. I mean, kind of the saying that you get your best ideas in the shower.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yeah. And so one of the things that there's a lot of research on this now is about working kind of in sprints and then taking some time off. And so what I've actually started to try to do is block like sprints. I'm going to spend 90 minutes, I think is the time frame that I've heard, of like working deep on something. Then I walk away and then do other things. And I found that for mental acuity, that's like one of the best things that I could do. Now, all these damn invites for meetings get in the way sometimes, but that's what I try to do.
But no, it's true. I mean, when you're trying to solve a complex problem or come up with a new idea, the research is there. But again, you know, some of my best ideas do come when I'm in the shower or when I went for a run or when I'm not thinking about what it is I'm trying to do or solve. You have that aha moment because you've stepped away and it goes back to, again, creating space.
Creating space.
Between you in the problem or whatever it is you're trying to solve.
So mind, body, what's the third
purpose.
Leg? Purpose.
And we've talked a lot about
that. So you've had this job for a couple of years now, is that right?
2.5 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
What is there something that you've learned that surprised you in this whole well-being area that maybe you didn't think of coming in?
First of all, I think when it comes to well-being, it's really easy for people to automatically go to physical well-being and, you know, exercise and diet. I mean, that's kind of automatically.
That's probably the U.S. definition of well-being for many people, right?
Yep. Very fair, very fair. Certainly kind of in the corporate world, right? And it also because it's people on, like people understand it, right? Like they understand what it means to go running, right? I think when you get into kind of mind and purpose, you know, some people will say that those are softer. I will say that those are essential. But I think the thing that I've learned about well-being is that it means something to everyone. Mm. And that's why it's so powerful. And it could change over time. And, you know, our broad kind of definition and framework of well-being is very intentional because we want people to be able to focus on what matters to them. Mm. You know, and some days what matters to me or what I need is sitting on the couch and reading a book. Even though my schedule, my calendar tells me I should be at the gym, I'm like, you know what? I don't need that right now. I need to sit on the couch and read a book, and that's okay. I think, you know, that the appreciation for well-being in the corporate world is starting to become, I mean, there's a real appreciation and a real understanding for it. And I think I thought going in, that was, you know, the business case for it was going to be a little bit more of a challenge than it actually was. And so I went in kind of guns blazing, like this is the hardcore business case, bottom line. And that's really important. I mean, in any business, I mean, it's a business. So in any business situation, but I know at Deloitte, the reaction has been, this is the right thing to do.
Right.
And we are in a client service business. You know, if our people aren't taking care of themselves, then we got nothing. You know, that's what faces off with our clients, with each other. I mean, that's who we are,
That's the only asset we have, right?
Yeah. Yep. So, you know, so it would be counterintuitive to use your word to not want to have a culture where you didn't want people to take care or you didn't promote people taking care of themselves.
So maybe your takeaway is that you didn't know how receptive kind of everybody was going to be, that now is the time to do this. Interesting.
Which is I think probably, I mean, when people hear me say that, they're probably like, nah, you know, like, but it's true. I mean, it was, I did think, not that people weren't going to be open to it, but it was more about, okay, this all sounds great, but then how is it going to impact me when I need to get something done?
Well, part of a reason why maybe people are so bought into it is everybody, for the most part, has a life, and they want to live a better life.
Right.
And if this is a path to doing it, you know, that's a good thing.
Great. And I think part of it, too, and this is why it's so important to have well-being be it's part of culture, right? So I think historically we've talked about well-being in terms of like programmatic things. So what benefits does your organization have, or what are the, you know, the fun kind of engaging campaigns that you run throughout the year? And I'm not saying those things aren't important. They're absolutely important and they are critical to support a culture of well-being, but it has to be part of the fabric of the culture of an organization, because I have to be able to define what well-being means for me and know that you're going to support it because you define what well-being means for you and I support it. And there can't be any, like, we can't dictate what well-being means. We need to, like, people need to define that for themselves and feel supported regardless of what it is, because there's, I mean, as many people as you have, you're going to have that many different definitions of well-being.
So, Jen, I'm like a huge podcast listener and love reading, and I know you do too. Do you have like a favorite podcast or book on well-being that you'd like to share? Or one that you give to people? It doesn't necessarily need to be your personal one, but if you were to recommend one to listen to or read, what would it be?
So my like current book that I'm obsessed with is Why We Sleep by Dr. Matthew Walker. I think that everybody should read that, because I think that there's a global sleep epidemic. I really do believe that, you know, we are getting as a species getting way less sleep than we need. And I think after you read the book, you'll understand kind of the societal and cultural implications that that's having globally, not just in the U.S. And it's a great book to read. There's a lot of science and data, but it's so well written, and it's an easy, it's a fun read, and he does something in the beginning of the book which is actually I think really really great. And if you want to know a little bit more about what the book is about, there's a TED Talk. Dr. Matthew Walker has a TED Talk, but in the beginning of the book he tells you to not read the book, like don't read the book instead of going to sleep. Like, I'd rather you take longer to like finish the book and get proper sleep than, you know, because I'm one of those people, if I get really into a book or like a movie or, you know, a series on Netflix, like I'll stay up. I'll be like, oh, just one more. Oh, just one more chapter. Oh, just one more, you know, and like I'll, you know, forego all that. So when, like he said that in the beginning of the book, I'm like, I like this guy. He gets it.
So it's okay if you're reading this book and you fall asleep. He's okay.
He says that too. Yeah. You know? So, and I think, you know, somebody that you and I also, you know, I think we're both big fans of is Dan Harris, and you know,
Harris.
I know that he's got, that book is the reason you started meditating, or you tried meditating.
10% happier. Yep.
And he has a new one that just came out too, like Meditation for Fidgety Skeptics.
Yeah.
So if you know, if anybody is, you know, like me and kind of a fledgling meditator, or wants to start meditating, or you know, I think it's just really well written and easy to relate to, because he does.
He's one of the best writers ever. He's so relatable, and he makes it for the common man.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I mean, all the things that I said about my own meditation practice, like I'm terrible at it. I can't sit still. I can't do it in quiet. I can't stop my, you know, I can't, you know, the point of meditating is not turning your brain off. But that's the first thing that people say. Oh, I can't sit in silence and turn my, you know, turn my thoughts off. You're not supposed to. Right. But and then just how judgmental most people are, like they try it for a week and they determine they're no good at it. And so they stop, you know, and so and he hits on all of those things in just a really relatable way.
He also has a good podcast. Too,
yeah. Yeah.
Called 10% Happier.
Yeah, he does.
Do you have a well-being role model? And you'll get bonus points if it's not like an obvious one.
A well-being role model.
Like somebody maybe that's a senior executive, CEO. Somebody that you'd be like, wow, I'm blown away that they're able to be the poster child for well-being.
Gosh, that's a really good question.
I think I've stumped Jen.
I think you've stumped me. I don't know that I have. Well, here's the thing. I think I have a lot of them. I don't know that there's one single
person
that I would hold up. And I actually think that in a lot of ways that makes sense, because well-being is, I mean, everybody
it's
struggles
hard.
With
yep.
it, you know, and I would actually be, I think it's hard because I also wouldn't want to put that person on a pedestal.
Sure.
Right. Because none of us are perfect.
Well, and you know what? I think what I would say is, if anybody were to say, oh, Mike, you do a good job, I'd be like, you don't understand how much I struggle with it.
Yeah.
Like on a daily basis.
Right. Right.
Which
well,
is probably-
and I think that's something I come across in my role. And you had asked me something about, you know, this earlier about, you know, is it, the expectations of people that people have of me just be by nature of my title, because my role is well-being and my title is all about well-being. You know, but I struggle with it just as much as everyone else does.
I think to a certain degree, it's just making it part of your life, meaning like actually thinking about your health, like your body, mind, spirit, like you talked about, and thinking about things that you can do to enhance it.
Yeah.
And if you do that, you're ahead of most people.
Right. And like I said, do it more often than not. Right. And and it's the kind of thing that, like, you know, people will go on a diet and then they'll, you know, they'll screw up, right? They'll fall off the wagon. They'll eat something bad. They'll, you know, and then they'll be like, oh, well, I already screwed up. So like, I'm just going to eat bad for the rest of the week and start over again next week. No, get back, like get right back on the wagon and keep going. You had one bad meal or you ate one bad thing. I mean, so I think that's true with every area of well-being. You know, that's why I say, like, for me, it's more often than not. It's not that I'm, you know, like I do this every single day without fail, because I absolutely don't. Because life doesn't work that way.
I should have asked you this earlier. I'm still going to ask you, even though it feels like it's out of place now, but that's okay. You had another LinkedIn article where you recommend several times of taking, that didn't make sense. You recommend taking time off several times throughout the year.
Mm-hmm.
What would be your recommendation, or what do you recommend to staff or people that come to you and say, I'm just too damn busy?
Well, I mean, so first of all, I would say plan those things ahead of time, right? Like, don't just kind of wait for them to happen or...
And when you say plan ahead of time, like a couple of weeks or months or maybe even a year?
No, I would say look at your year and say, you know, this is when I want to take some time off and this is when I want to take vacation and communicate that ahead of time.
I think, you know what's funny? That, and I'm sure you have more to add.
Yeah.
That is probably one of the best strategies that I've found because the beautiful thing about technology is you can block it and say, I'm out. And people actually respect that because then they'll be like, oh, he must be out. So I'm not going to bother him at that point in time. We won't schedule something.
Right. And so, but I think that if you kind of wait for it to happen or you have in your head, you know, it kind of goes back to my story of burnout. You know, how did I get to that place was because I said, oh, I can just get through this next project or this next thing or, you know, September 9th or September, you know, October 22nd. I can just get there, right? I think if you wait for time off to happen at a time when you're not busy, it's not going to happen because you're always going to feel like you're too busy.
Right.
There's always going to be things going on. It doesn't matter what it is. But if you plan it, you know, plan your, you know, what your strategy is for the whole year, then you have that locked in your mind of what it is. And I would say plan something. Like plan to, you know, even if it's a staycation, like plan what that's going to be so it becomes a non-negotiable.
Right.
Put, you know, go ahead and book, if you're going to go somewhere, book the flights, book the hotel, and book them non-refundable. You know, like make it hard to cancel.
Change your mind, yeah. Cool. Couple last questions. And this is always my favorite one, so I'm going to say it slowly so you can think about it. But I always love asking people the one question that they always wanted to answer, but they've never been asked. And really what I'm getting at, is there anything that we haven't covered here today where you're like, you know what, if there's one thing for people to remember about well-being, or if there's one thing that is important to me, what is that question? And then what's your answer? And I'm really good with the silence, so we could just.
Okay, so I don't know that I know exactly what the question is.
Yep. And that's okay.
But I think when it comes to well-being, what I want people to know or kind of walk away, like if they don't remember anything that you or I say, I think it's this notion of number one, I mean, it's not selfish to put yourself first and be intentional about it. And when you do that, the people that need you and the way that you show up is going to be better. You're going to be a better person for it. You're going to show up better. You're going to be more engaged. You're going to feel better. And that's going to come through in everything that you do. But I think with well-being, it's so easy to kind of put ourselves last, right? Or to tell ourselves that taking this time for myself to do what I need to is being selfish. And it's not. As a matter of fact, the people that you care about need you to take care of yourself because what's the alternative? I mean, you croak and die. Is that good for the people that you care about? No, right? And so you need if you're not going to do it for yourself, do it for the people that you love.
Right. Well, and if you just step back and you think about it, I mean, and you just go through kind of the way you defined well-being, if you take care of yourself better from a health perspective, you're going to show up better with your family. Yeah. You're going to have more endurance at work.
Yeah.
If you take better care of kind of your mind through meditation or whatever, you're not going to overreact. I mean, there's so many different examples. And so I think your point, which this may be a great place to end this, is like, if there's one thing to take away, it's put yourself first because you're going to be better to all of those around you, including your job.
That and share it with others, because when you share it with others, you empower them to do the same.
Awesome. Well, Jen, I know I put you through the ringer, but I appreciate you being on Resilience.
Loved every minute of it.
Okay, good.
I need to go do some recovery so I can be resilient.
Exactly. I need to go take a nap.
Yes.
All right, we'll go do that. Thanks, Jen.
Thank you.
Wow, that was incredible. Jen, I want to really thank you. You know, you shared some stuff that I've never heard you talk about. I know for me, I took away a lot of tactics or rituals or behaviors that I'm probably going to change to become more resilient myself, to live a better life. So thank you for that. And I want to thank all of you who subscribe and listen to Resilient. You know, I love getting feedback on the episodes, when you share kind of who your favorite interviews are. So I really want to thank everybody out there. I also want to thank my friends at Rivet Radio. They do such an incredible job partnering with Deloitte to make me sound good, to pull these podcasts together, to produce them. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And I encourage you to check out some of our previous episodes. We have great interviews with CEOs, board members, and leaders. I was reminded the other day, the guy who led NATO, the Supreme Allied Commander, I still can't believe I got Admiral Stavridis on. And if you like my conversation with Jen, like I indicated before, check out my conversations with Mallory Wegman and Dick Donahue. And if you're enjoying these conversations, share them with your work colleagues, family, and friends. The thing I love more than anything is that my sister and other family members and some of my friends who have nothing to do with business actually enjoy these. And I'd be extremely, extremely grateful if you could just spend 1 minute and provide us with a rating. Ratings play such a large role in how we get the word out. Finally, hit me up on LinkedIn or Twitter. My profile is under Michael Kearney. Last name is spelled K-E-A-R-N-E-Y. My Twitter handle is mkearney33. Take care and have a wonderful day.